Well, there's another one in between us who's called Johnny Lou, who is the art director on the campaign with us, and we work together. And he's a wonderful character, and he's good friends with Ollie, and I've met Ollie, but I loved his work, and it seemed to kind of epitomise exactly what we wanted to do with the band. So we met in
we met on a local shoot, actually.
That was it.
And I feel like in England we've got this thing called Marmite, and I'm a little bit like that. It's either like you really like how it goes or you hate it. And with you, we sort of connected, and it was love at sight a little bit.
Yeah, so the first show we did for the look book, Ollie decided to take his top off. Was dancing around with the girl, trying to get her to move in the right direction.
Deeply unprofessional.
Really unprofessional. And so, yeah. And you pretty much danced for 24 hours, didn't you?
Yeah, it was a 24-hour music dance video.
Can you show us, please?
No, please don't do that. You're a terrible dancer. But yeah, I think it's just, you know, DVF's an amazing brand, and it has so many incredible things from the past that make people kind of fall in love with it. People have an emotional connection with the brand. But then it's been perceived in one way, and I think it's my job, and then with the job with Ollie, to interpret it in a new way. And I think that it's about taking all those values for the brand and just reinterpreting it. I think, you know, rather than, you know, we're being huge established photographers working on the brand for years, or models that were kind of household names. It was much more about a new approach, which took it in a different direction. And so I needed somebody like Ollie to be able to do that.
It's interesting talking about sort of reshaping and reforming the brand, because there's a quote that Andrew Bolton wrote in the book, which I think is really interesting, where he said, fashion is by its very nature collaborative, and I don't think it's something that gets talked about enough. Like, media often fetishizes like the star designers working in the ivory tower, but actually like, any great collection or any great fashion photograph relies on like an army of people. And just tell me a bit more about how you've sort of realised that throughout your career, and sort of how important it is to let others into your vision to be able to sort of develop it and push it forward.
You have to. It's about a different interpretation. I think we all work pretty hard. I think the longer you stay on something, the longer you work on something, the harder it is to see the end quality. And so I think every stage throughout the process of any creative design process, I guess, or pulling a collection together, the next bringing somebody else in to look at it a different way is so important. I think that as long as you can kind of not take yourself too seriously, then it's pretty, it works well, right?
I think that's what we bonded on, is there was a free spirit. And actually, before Johnny, I'd started my career, if you can call it that, but started working. And I found it quite hard because I feel like we are in a bit of an age when it gets to sort of brands, a corporation sort of way of working. But with Johnny, I suddenly met someone who made me feel like we could just work as friends, and everything was like between me, you, and a couple other people, and it was like not about the larger, like the larger group of like marketing. And
very instinctive way of
working. Yeah, and I feel like my best stuff, every time I've tried to do other, and my agent's actually standing in the corner. She, starting in America, especially America, I'll be on like a 5-6 day job, and quite a corporate job, and by the fourth day I got quite bad ADHD. I was ripping my hair out, and either saying, I can't do this, or this, it doesn't feel right. But with Jonathan, it was, and I think we learned that when we first met, it was suddenly like, fuck, sorry, I'm not allowed to swear.
He was
doing
it. Swear.
No, I'm sorry. I was like, this is the connection, this is what I'm sort of... It sounds really awful as a reference, but I was obsessed with Billy Elliot when I was a kid. And when he's in the room, talking about why there's music as we speak, and when he's in the hall and he's speaking about why he likes dancing, he says it's like electricity. And I suppose for me it's the same thing when taking pictures. And with Jonathan, I suddenly found someone who like wasn't like, okay, let's stop. He was actually how you do it yourself.
You have to let somebody work in a way that feels natural. You can plan a campaign, you can plan a brand kind of image or whatever as much as you want to, but the spontaneity that brings all the good stuff is the most important part. We did 7 locations in 2 days, video, cutdowns. The requirements for a campaign these days is pretty much insane.
Talk us a little bit through like the practical side of the collaboration, because obviously to you guys it's your work and it's your routine, but I think to a lot of people here, how a fashion campaign is put together is deeply interesting and relies on a lot of people sort of coming together and doing their best work. So how does it begin with the concept, the idea, and then right through to the shoots?
Yeah, I mean, I briefed Johnny and Ollie about, first of all, because it's the first campaign for the brand, so it wasn't just like a collection, so it's not like this season it's all about blah blah blah. It was much more, you know, this brand stands for these values, how do we interpret these values in a cool way, in a modern way, in a way that resonates with people now instead of people 20 years ago. People don't want to be patronised, people want to see real life in real situations, and so that was again on the top level what we started off as. It still has to have that feeling of glamour, but it's like not in a kind of contrived way, not in an over-retouched and polished way. But all these photographs and video seem to be able to capture that. It looks expensive, it looks desirable, but it also looks real. And all of those are reasons why you want to talk to them. And I guess we talked about different situations in a woman's life, walking through New York, which is the home of the brand and the home of the story we're trying to tell, and how different women of different backgrounds can interact with real people. So not only was it models in the campaign, but we also had loads of real people from the city of New York, which we underestimated how much that would be.
So you were literally walking around New York trying to find people to be in a DVF campaign.
Yeah, I mean, like, we couldn't plan half of it. We met with the guy we met in the past. We were shooting in the park in East Village.
And this photographer started taking pictures of us taking pictures.
And he's in the campaign.
And production ended up being like, "God, get him away, get him away." But we ended up saying like, "Okay, wait," and he actually looked amazing. So we ended up saying, "Let him take pictures." Yeah. We said, "You can take as many pictures as you want as long as we can take a picture of you."
Yeah. There was kids breakdancing in the street in Harlem. We captured everything in the campaign. So half of the stuff was spontaneous. You know, obviously there's lots of planning involved. But a lot of the beautiful things that happen with the spontaneous stuff, and I think that's why the talent people like Ollie can capture that, but it's still an polished way.
But I think, but I think it did start with, you know, when Jonathan came to Johnny Lou is not here, he did actually say, "Can I be FaceTimed in?" So,
egomania.
Yeah, he's got an ego. But it started with the art director, and then he said, him and Johnny said, "Would you like to do it?" And I think for something like this, for a photographer, it's very rare to suddenly find a brand and who not need a makeover, but are in a huge transition. And with a designer like Jonathan, who is so open and free, it's really amazing to find someone, and it's really rare. And when that happened and I realised Jonathan was that guy, you suddenly were like, I was going to say F word, but I was like, yes, this I need to put really a lot of time into. We're in a bit of a trouble now because there isn't as much time as probably was there in the 80s, 90s, and even maybe early 2000s with things, projects like this, because you have to do in 2 days what probably would have been done over 2 weeks. But the moment meeting Johnny and talking about it, we realised we really needed to invest time into it to make it amazing. So me and Johnny Lou, that is, and Jonathan, quite confusing two Johnnies, but we did spend about 2 months building up to the actual shoot, and I think it's the preparation which you tell when people ask, "Oh, how long did you do it in? How is it possible?" You know, I have other clients who come and say, "You know, how can we do something like that now?" Actually, you know, I say, oh, well, and they're like, how long can you do it? And you say 2 days, but I never actually tell them the secret isn't the 2 days, it's the 2 months building up, and it's actually the friendship you build with the art director and the designer. And actually, that's the key to this job now. When you haven't got much time to actually do the shoot, it's about actually building relationships with the people you're working with to then, like, hopefully take it to the next level.
Do you think it makes you braver when you collaborate with someone? Because often when you're on your own and you're being creative, you know, you have that thing of talking yourself out of an idea. Whereas actually when you have someone to sort of bounce ideas off and to validate things and legitimise things, it can be easier to push something
quickly. I think being alone is the key.
Yeah.
So.
But also it's got to be there's got to be a set of opportunities, you know, so on many occasions whenever I've worked with people in the past, it's not always great. You know, it's not always something where two people see things in the same way or respect each other's point of view and therefore allow it to evolve. So I think it needs that special kind of connection between two people's personalities in order to be able to make it work.
So is that connection it's a bit like a romantic relationship, like it either works or it doesn't work.
I think it is a romance because it's like a, not a family, but it is a, I like having people along, and it's quite important to the whole process. It's a more visceral relationship. It is quite intimate, and I think that's quite important. And actually, I'm a Cancer, I'm not a big believer in a month on month, but I'm quite a family man, so I think when I'm working, I work best when I feel supported by a family. I feel like Jonathan is a family, in a way. You know, doesn't answer all my text messages, but it's okay. But I think it is that family atmosphere where you can then build, and I think it's also really important that both Jonathan and myself work from New York. So we all have this idea of what New York is, this fantasy of New York. I used to, as a kid, I'd love the idea of America and New York. And for me, coming here, we're able to look at New York and Manhattan in a different way, and that really helped. And that's that kind of like push with like, and maybe if there was an American person in the mix of it, maybe it would have been slightly different, but we felt like dreamers, and all three of us were dreamers. And I think that was really important to it. So family and dreamers are a key word to take away.
I have a question slightly related to sort of you talked about time, both of you know, having less time to work on shoots. You know, in the 60s, photographers would go away for 2 weeks to shoot an editorial for Vogue or whatever magazine, and they'd have, you know, weeks to do editorials and campaigns, whereas now you're given a couple of days. And I'm interested, just going back to the theme of collaboration, like whether one of the benefits of working with someone who you do have this close synergy with is someone to sort of help you be robust through that sort of punishing pace of fashion. Like quite a lot of people that I interviewed in the book talked about that. Like Victor Rolf was like, doing this on your own would be horrible, which I thought was quite a bold way of putting it.
I think the demands are high, and I think the expectations are high, and I think especially when it comes to content collateral that we produce in terms of brand voice and brand vision, there's so many layers to it now, and I think that the nature of it means that you could easily end up just knocking out stuff with no meaning. It's like that's the danger. But I think if you collaborate with somebody that's a grafter and works hard and has a creative kind of is creatively inspired, I guess, then you can achieve no end of wonderful things. I think I was so surprised at how much we managed to turn around in those 2 days. It was pretty insane. One minute we were on the bus.
We
did a tour on the bus. Where else did we go?
Midtown.
On the Staten Island Ferry at 6 a.m.
And a Tompkins Square Park.
So I think you could, like, there's often there's a lot of photographers that would never do that. You know, and never, like, the kind of...
It feels like a night out. Like a night out. I always like to be the last person, which is not very good. And this felt a bit like that when I have this really bad or good trait that however tired I am, I can actually somehow in my most tired moment find even more energy than I had at the start. So it feels like when we're working, you kind of find the energy to kind of to push through. And I think what's hard is you do something for... I remember actually reading a book about Bruce and Calvin, about how they would go off together.
That's where we're in Calvin Pratt.
Yeah. How they'd go off together to Greece, and they like some of their campaigns were shot across 2-3 weeks, and actually they'd go just themselves. But for me, this is the first brand that I worked with where maybe we had to do this, try and do the same sort of amount of pictures in 2 days. But the brilliant thing on this collaboration was I found a designer who probably was not dissimilar to Calvin at that moment, in the sense, not in style, in the way he worked. And actually, Jonathan didn't say that there wasn't like a crowd of a marketing team or another big team or something checking that everything was in focus team or some other team doing peanuts and something. But he was able to just make it just us two and Johnny and the stylist, and it was a small unit, it was a family.
That's where the best, the work is the best, you know? And to take away all of that and allow people to be able to do, to be free enough to be able to come up with good ideas. I think that that is, I guess, the key in a good collaborative process.
Do you argue with each other?
A little.
You argue about the poem.
That's the context of the poem.
The poem was a story through poetry about a woman in New York, and it was the thing that was played over the campaign video. And we tried to find the right person to talk to write that poem and to tell the story, and then we got something, oh, I was like, oh, it sounds really cheesy. And then we changed it, we did it again, and we got somebody else to record the video, and our voice didn't sound right. It was like the most agonizing part of the entire campaign, even though it was probably the smallest part of notice that much, but it was pretty tough, right? That was the only time.
It was tough, right? Yeah. But I think we could probably have a really good argument in a good positive way.
Yeah. Let's do it in the next one.
Next one.
Which is next weekend, by the way.
Yeah, I was going to ask that.
Marathon weekend.
Yeah, can you talk to me about moving forward with this collaboration? Is this something that you want to be, a sizable chunk of your sort of creative lives, that you enjoy the idea of continuing to work together?
Yeah, we're getting married next week. And yeah, every campaign for the rest of my life will be with all.
But do you find the more familiar you are with someone, it's easier? Like, I imagine, yeah.
We're not easy people.
No, surely not.
But I think actually that's what makes it really good, is we're quite honest. And I feel like, I mean, not to, there's nothing against America, I'll say it first. But in LA, I find when I'm in LA, it's not as honest straight away, maybe a little bit more here, but I feel like what's amazing about our relationship and our bond is we're potentially quite rude to each other straight away in each other's faces, which helps quite a lot. You know, he's Scottish, so it's quite hard for me as well.
Why?
Reputation, yeah.
Tell me a little bit more, just broader question, zooming out from the personal insults, about the role that imagery plays in brands today, because that's also really interesting about this collaboration, is it's a visual one about making photographs and videos, and that's obviously so essential to how fashion is communicated today, and has changed so much. You know, it used to be one campaign for a magazine, whereas now it's all these different assets for different sort of channels. And just talk to me about how important that is for you in communicating your vision for the DVF.
I think, I manage the marketing team at DVF as well as the design, visual merchandising and architecture. So it's been a bit of a baptism of fire. I think learning about the requirements these days for the amount of assets that you need, it could very easily sway towards that side of just producing stuff for stuff's sake and trying to really focus on only the product and not the vision of the dream. I think the storytelling is just so important. This brand was founded on storytelling. You know, it was about a woman who started a brand about empowering women and making being able to change their life, I guess, and the way that they dress and the way that they have their attitude, I guess. And so I think that those kind of stories are important, and even more important than that. I think there's so many brands out there. I think what you need to do is focus on telling the story of a specific brand and believing in what that brand stands for, and telling it, yes, in a new way and in terms of a different way, but not forgetting the importance of storytelling. And for me, a beautiful picture can say 1,000 words and portray an emotion which people can connect with.
And also start, not a conflict, but it's about starting a discussion. And I feel like a lot of campaigns nowadays, they're potentially quite nice pictures, and I don't know whether that is the best thing. I think what's actually quite nice is starting a conversation, and I feel like these set of images starting a conversation, even to the point where you'd be like, oh, I like where it is, or, you know, this and that. And I think it's really important to start a dialogue between it.
Absolutely. And it takes trust as well. Like, it was a big, big change for the brand in terms of the look and feel of the images that we put out. The logo had changed, the brand image had changed, basically everything had changed kind of very quickly. And also always used on film, so you can't, you're not looking at it on the screen straight away. So there's a lot of trust involved, and so you have to kind of, and, you know, obviously it's a really important moment, and, well.
Trust.
What, are you doing a trust?
No, it's okay, yeah.
So that is a big important part of it, but because we trusted each other, the end result I feel is beautiful. It's like, I'm the most proud of it, of anything I've done, so.
Should we open up the floor to questions? There's going to be Fran's walking around with a microphone. Does anyone have anything they would like to ask? Anyone going to be brave? Come on.
Hi.
There
you go. Hey, my name is Alexandra. I just have questions about, you know, a lot of like luxury brands or like fashion brands are trying to keep up with the trend and like do the campaign across different channels, including the digital assets. So how do you, but some of them apparently afraid of moving towards the digital side. So like, how do you think that a brand should balance the traditional like channels versus the like, more trendy or like digital channels?
I think it's about, you know, you have to look at things in terms of how people are viewing content these days. So the campaign was actually shot, even though shot in a very traditional way, was also planned to be in all the formats necessary for digital platforms. So all of our amplification, the majority of our amplification on the campaign was digital, through banners and through third party, through Instagram. Like all, everything was thought of in that way and framed around that kind of format, but still respecting and still being in love with the traditional form of print. And not in a kind of old-fashioned way, just in a kind of in a nostalgic way. And I think that that is still something that is important to me. I know it's important to you as well. And it just depends on what the audience is. I think that, you know, there's certain publications where the audience is where print and that way of seeing media is still a relevant format. And because we shot both film and video, focusing on the hero images, but also on focusing on product, then I think we had the best of both worlds, really. So yeah, it's there from the start in terms of the framework, but it's also never should ignore the beauty in that kind of spontaneous capturing of an image, you know?
And I think all the images and the videos end up on different kind of medias, and actually we spend hours cutting down to different second sizes for the video there is, but and all the stills ended up online or on different formats. But I feel like the smell of paper and stuff still is important, I think.
You have to know about it, but then you have to can't be led by it, so that then it dictates exactly what the creative looks like. You know, because you lose that sense of freedom and freedom of expression. So I think understanding it, but kind of knowing when
following to, your heart.
Yeah, exactly.
It's a really good question.
Yes, you designed my dress, and I have to tell you, my name is Rona.
Hi, Rona.
Hi. stop me everywhere I go. I've men follow me. So can I touch your dress?
The Venn diagram dress we call that. I love that. It's my favorite.
It's amazing. It's the most incredible fabric. And I, please make something else for me.
Resort 2013, right? For my own, yeah. 14.
Yes, but what happened was I left the store, I didn't buy it, I was with a girlfriend of mine.
Okay.
We talked about the dress, and talked about the dress, and talked about the dress, and finally it was just like, well, it's not going up on the dress. Favorite dress.
Well, that's why we love fashion, right? Love clothes.
Thank you very much.
I'm not sure if anyone will be able to top that. Does anyone else have a question, a statement, anything they would like to get up with? Okay. Hi. Can you give us an example of how conflict actually led to creative process? Because you've touched upon it and love to understand more about how it works.
I think, sorry, I'm going to try, it's a very good question. I'm quite an emotional being, and I think Jonathan is a very emotional being, and I think that's where the conflict works. It works in the sense of you have fire and water, or vice versa, or fire and fire. And I think creativity, for me anyway, I also, I wanted to be a football player before. It's about losing yourself in the moment a little bit, and you need a team. I think the key is a team. And I think you need a team, and you need a team who can be really honest to each other. And I think when that happens and we're not stroking egos, I do feel there's no ego stroking when we work together. And I think that's what makes the collaboration really good, is it's, there's a truth to it. And I think conflict brings truth. It sounds like I do a psychiatric.
He's really good at saying really profound
things.
Steve Jobs, I think.
Steve
Jobs. Do you have anything to ask that sort of thing? Do you think it's basically similar?
Yeah, I think it's just honesty. I think when it comes to the balance between creativity and commerciality, I think that's where, you know, I work for a company that I believe in, I work and I report to a board that have criteria and results that need to happen. And I work with creatives who I respect, who I want to give enough freedom to be able to express themselves and do what they want to do. And so I guess the conflict for me is working between those two worlds and making sure that neither compromises or affects the other too much, you know? I guess that's my kind of form of conflict that actually, hopefully, brings good results.
Hope's a good word to use, because I think when you hope for something, it means there's a level of doubt. Actually, the doubt is actually the thing that hopefully, again, makes it quite electric. It's the, you're not, the chance is the thing that makes it good, I think. It's not when you turn up to a shoot and everything's prepared exactly and you try and get the shirt or the dress exactly how it needs to sell or the thing to be exactly right. You overproduce, and actually it's about roughing it up a little bit, getting a great model and a great team, and then you kind of like actually tear it down.
Just hard. Like we accidentally cropped out all the shoes every shot on the campaign. In retrospect, maybe not the smartest thing to do.
You did do that one shoe shop with a dog.
Yeah. Which we didn't.
You didn't use.
Yes.
Any final questions? Yes,
I
right
there.
Everyone's like warmed up now.
My question is basically, what do you think your response has been overall since you've been at DVF? And have you felt that you've been able to use your same creativity? And have you been held back in any kind of way with your own creativity?
No, I mean, I've never held back with anything.
Yeah.
I think you have to be confident with your own ideas. I think the wonderful thing about working with a brand that has a history like this is that if you respect it, then you're able to do wonderful things, you're able to interpret it in your own way, but you also are able to grasp onto, like, and connect with the brand. I think that I was fascinated by the brand because the individual who founded it was provocative, strong, and sexy, yeah. it's been stopped. But and also who's somebody who's open-minded enough to allow somebody to interpret it in a new way. And so with that mutual respect, therefore you're able to explore different ideas, try different things, and work with people that you want to work with, you know? I think that that was important for me when taking on the role. And I think that's why Diane kind of respected me, because I had a strong opinion and I didn't mess my words and was very straight with her and the brand about what I wanted to do. And so therefore, that kind of attitude is what you need in order to be able to reinvent something, but be respectful about something and try to articulate it in a new way while still being, not just respectful, but true to what the brand stands for. I'm not a woman, so therefore I can't speak on behalf of women in that way, but I respect women, I hope that that comes across in the clothes, and I am inspired by them every day. And so there's a lot for me to learn, but also I feel like it is the right thing for the brand, and I feel that I'm in the right position right now. That makes sense? And how does the reaction go? I mean, I don't know. I can't pay too much attention to that. If you pay too much attention to what people think,
you're fucked.
Sorry. No, I didn't.
Kids in the
front
row, so.
Three.
Four.
Three.
Maybe it's.
yeah. And I'm not going to ask you what you think. Any terrible job.
Any more questions? Last one then.
Hey, so it's me again. So I have a question. How do you balance DVF's core branding and expanding to other product lines? For example, people will first, if you mention DVF to them, they will think about the red dress. And but what if you also want to promote other products, for example, jeans or like.
Did you see the jeans last week?
Yeah. So
did you like them?
Yeah. I like them. It's just like I want to know how you, as like show creative director, like how do you balance the core branding versus expanding to the new concept or like new product.
To me, that my first job is to look at what the values of the brand were, what the values of that dress was, because she was an inventor, she was an entrepreneur, and she started something that stood for a certain kind of ethos and a mindset. How does that translate into other products? So rather than trying to jazz up a wrap dress in different ways, take the reasons why it worked. You know, it was effortless, it was colorful, it was creative, and it had a point of view. It wasn't a black wrap dress, it wasn't a basic garment that had no point of view. It certainly said something.
Embodied.
The notion of decoration. So you take all of those values and how is that translated into a pant or a blouse or a bag or other products? So it's not difficult. I think that it's just, it's just a process of being able to take those values and expand on it and take it into other categories that the brand, you know, should always have. You know, it's about a lifestyle, it's about a wardrobe, and it's about an attitude. And so I think that all of those things are something that I try to incorporate into all categories rather than just dresses.
Fascinating insights to an amazing relationship, and it's fascinating to see how this brand has been redeveloped and changed and pushed forward. So thank you so much. I encourage everyone to have a drink, have a browse of the collection.
Thank you, everyone.
Have a look at the awesome.